So good morning to all of you. I would like to share with you first the background of the proposed activities through this and such workshops in future. I presume most of the teachers would have read the theme paper which we had put up on the website for registration. I am primarily going to use that theme paper to illustrate the various aspects which led to this workshop and beyond. First and foremost, the objective of the workshop. Ordinarily, when teachers attend an IST workshop, the activity is spread over about 2 weeks and a specific subject matter is discussed at length, thereby enhancing the knowledge of the participating teachers with the hope that when they go back and teach that subject at their own respective institutions, the students benefit because of this enhancement. That has been the standard model that the country has used so far. However, there is one problem, and that is of scale. The number of teachers who can participate meaningfully in such workshops is often limited to 25, 30, 35 teachers for a subject because they have to physically assemble at one place. Using the modern information and communication technology, however, it is feasible to address a much larger number of participants who might be spread across the country at different places. However, they can assemble at the same time at these different places. And if the communication infrastructure is available, they can all participate in a workshop where the lectures can be delivered from any one of the places. Thankfully, the ISRO technology and the EDUSAT infrastructure permits us to do that today. So the objective here is to conduct IST-like workshops on a very large scale. I must repeat again that the kind of scale that we are attempting to achieve, about 1,000 teachers at a time, has never been possible in the past. And this is where I believe that in the coming years, ICT will make a lot of difference in scaling up our efforts. The workshops that we plan to conduct are going to be subject-centric. This pilot workshop that we are conducting is centered around computer programming, effective teaching and learning in computer programming is the subject matter of this workshop, and that is the objective. Before coming to the specific subject matter and the details of the workshop schedule, I would like to share with all of our teacher colleagues some of the background that led to this particular methodology being adopted. As I said, the major issues which were identified started with the issue of scale. I would like to remind our teacher colleagues that there was a time not too long ago, about 25 years ago, when there were hardly 50 to 70 engineering colleges in the country. Almost all of them were funded by the government. This was the situation in late 70s and even up to early 80s. Subsequently, a very large number of engineering institutions have come up into the country. Today they number more than 3,500. The number of students admitted to these colleges is more than 5 lakh per year. These 500,000 students who come every year into our engineering college streams are taught by over 100,000 teachers across the country. This kind of scale-up has never been achieved in any other country so far. But when you scale up like this, there are some imminent problems. And the problems are, the greatest worry is whether the quality of education suffers. It is in this context that I had undertaken a one-year-long sabbatical sort of mini Bharat Yatra when I went around the country visiting engineering colleges just to ascertain the kind of problems that these colleges faced. It is that experience which led me to believe that while there are good students everywhere in the country, the academic infrastructure has not evolved to meet the demands of the scale. We had started in IIT Bombay a distance education program through a satellite infrastructure before the ISRO's EDUSAT came up. And with that experience, we thought it would be possible to use the modern technology to address larger number of teachers. However, what are specifically the issues other than scale needs to be kept in mind when we scale up our attempts. That is because there have been earlier attempts using precisely the same technology to address teaching learning processes in specific areas. So we thought we would take a review of all the issues which concern us and specifically embark on a path which could be most effective for the limited objective of enhancing quality of science and engineering education in the country. So the first issue that I mentioned is that of the scale. This is well understood. Associated with the scale, however, is the issue of educational background of our teachers. If you look at the traditional university system, the faculty members are expected to be researchers in their respective areas, and they are also supposed to teach the undergraduate, postgraduate, and doctoral students. However, as the number of engineering colleges increased very rapidly, it was not possible for the nation to produce adequate number of people with postgraduate and doctoral qualification to serve as teachers. As a result, the educational background of most of our teachers in large number of engineering colleges consists of the first degree in engineering or a master's degree in science. It is not bad at all, because if the major teaching is happening at the undergraduate level, this education appears to be seemingly adequate. However, the conventional wisdom says that the teachers must be far more qualified than the students whom they are teaching, except of course at the high end of postdoctoral research, where teachers and students work almost as teams. Unfortunately, since the fact of situation is that most teachers come with a basic degree in engineering, it creates some kind of a problem, because these teachers not only have the first degree in engineering, they also do not have large number of years of experience which is expected in the teaching faculty when they teach students. After all, when you do a postgraduate degree and a PhD, you essentially gain 5 to 6 years of additional experience in the teaching learning process, although you may not be a teacher at that time. That experience helps you mature further, and that in turn helps you to do effective teaching. So we have a dual problem. We have a problem that our teachers lack the necessary educational background of post-graduation and PhD. I must mention here that it is not that the teachers do not want to acquire the postgraduate degrees or do not want to do PhD. Quite on the contrary, most of the teachers in the country are more than willing to get an opportunity to enhance their qualifications and to do further studies. However, the infrastructure of the postgraduate degree and doctoral programs in the country is completely inadequate to cater to the large growing needs. And that is why we have to ensure that these teachers with the first degree also can effectively participate and enhance the teaching learning process at the undergraduate level. The third major problem that we face is the mindset of students. Most of the students today are focused on passing examinations with good marks and grades. Please note that this is not something new that has happened in the last few years. Ever since we have a school or college educational system where examinations are conducted and marks are allocated, every ambitious young mind will attempt to maximize the score in any evaluation that is carried out. Getting good marks in a degree is always the first objective of any student. However, this objective has a simultaneous activity of immense amount of learning, which then get tested in the examination. In the past few years, you will find that since the main objective has become getting good grades and marks, students are inclined to spend more time with guidebooks, with coaching classes, and with preparation for the examination system that they have to appear for, rather than attending regular classes, attending tutorials, and attending labs. This has been a disturbing trend, and something ought to be done to reverse this trend. It is not easy, however, that is because the university system today is far more syllabus bound and examination bound. Hopefully things will change in coming years, and I will comment on this in my subsequent lecture. But today the fact of life is that students wish to study for the set examination pattern, and their first objective is to maximize their marks. This mind shift has occurred because our university education system has been unable to emphasize problem solving abilities as the fundamentally most important activity in engineering and scientific educational process. It is in this context that we can examine the mindset of teachers. And we find another problem that has cropped up in the country. At any point in time, in any society, there is a certain number of people who are interested and inclined to pursue academic careers. However, if you consider the remuneration packages which are offered by business and industry to smart young people today, with the remuneration packages that are offered to teachers today, the discrepancy has become extremely glaring, particularly in the last decade or so. As a result, the young individual who passes out of a college, either he or she or his or her family are not particularly inclined to take up an academic career, because they do not foresee any subsequent material growth for themselves and their families in that profession. The fact that in spite of this problem, there are people who are available for teaching tells us that it is one of the two reasons which is responsible for availability of teachers in the first place. The first reason, of course, is that in spite of these discrepancies, there are several people who are so inclined towards academics that they take up academics as a career. The second set of people are those who are perhaps wanting to use the academics as a stepping stone and to shift over to industry for better remuneration. One cannot find fault with such people. After all, maximizing gains in one's life has to be the major objective of any young and ambitious individual. However, if I put myself into the shoes of a young person who aspires to get higher remuneration in the industry and has joined the teaching program merely as a stepping stone to learn a little bit more and to be properly employed while one searches for better opportunities elsewhere, I find that my mind is less focused on the activity of teaching than it would have been if I was completely committed to an academic career. This is natural and this cannot be helped. One of the objectives of this program is to encourage all participating teachers to think that no matter for how long they are committed to this academic profession, whether they are here for 1 month, 1 year, 1 decade, or for the whole life, there is an immense amount of gain for themselves and for the others if they keep in mind that teaching can not only be extremely enjoyable, can also be professionally very productive, making them better professionals in turn. It is this mindset of the teachers which therefore is an issue that needs to be addressed. Last but not the least is the limitations of our educational administrators. By educational administrators, I not only mean the agencies which run the educational institutions. These could be central government, state government, these could be trusts, these could be private bodies. The leadership in all these organizations are the primary educational administrators at the highest level. They do not administer day-to-day education, but they decide the policy, they decide the investment in infrastructure, and they decide in general how a program would be run. It also includes the university system with its affiliation chain, which decides what kind of syllabus would be used for teaching and so on. The educational administrators also include the directors and principals of engineering colleges, the deans of engineering colleges, the heads of the departments, and in fact, even the laboratory in charges who are faculty members themselves. A faculty member, therefore, is often required to play a dual role. On one hand, a faculty member is a teacher teaching one or more particular subjects in a manner defined by the university syllabus. On the other hand, the same faculty member is also an educational administrator struggling to set up the lab with inadequate resources that are available at his or her command, or a dean who is trying to figure out how to address the growing number of students with limited number of faculty members, or a principal or a director who is struggling to make two ends meet with the limited finances which are available at his or her disposal. Many of us teachers forget that the problems faced by educational administrators are quite real. Many times we wonder why such and such facility is not being made available, without realizing that the educational administrators have to do a tightrope walk in trying to balance the available resources with the heavy demands that any professional educational infrastructure puts up. In the developed countries, the situation is different and is taken care of by one of the two means. One, extremely heavy funding from the government, or two, very high fees charged to the students. Because without adequate financial resources, it is not possible to address the the problems of the educational infrastructure. Consider this, for example, in my mini Bharat Yatra, I used to ask many leaders from the educational administration system, including the trustees and the directors and the principals, that when you say you are not able to attract talented people as teachers, why don't you simply announce a triple or four times the salary that is offered by the government to attract teachers? What I was told consistently is that they may be willing to do that, provided the government permits them to charge realistic fees to the students. Unfortunately, the fees that is charged to the students is governed by or is regulated by the government without leaving a scope for very large resources to be gathered through that route. That is in fact important for this country, because large number of students may not be able to pay very high amount of fees. This dilemma will continue to haunt our educational administrators for some time. However, I can only expect that using such mechanisms as this workshop, the educational administrators will be able to encourage the teachers in their institutions to be more effective within the limited resources that are available to them. As I will comment later, this use of ICT need not be limited only to enhancement of teaching learning process. It can in fact also be used to encourage joint research work or joint postgraduate project activities with large number of faculty members across multiple colleges. And evolution of a collaborative framework for doing this kind of work is also going to be one of the objectives of this experiment. I will now like to briefly discuss the background efforts at IIT Bombay. My colleague Professor Kannan has already informed you about the establishment of Center for Distance Engineering Education Program and the number of courses that have been transmitted and which we continue to transmit. The process actually started in year 2000 when IIT started its first distance education program limited to information technology through the then established Kamal Rekhi School of IT. For the first 3 years we ran this program, and subsequently when we tried to figure out how to reach larger number of people, this idea of addressing teachers and working professionals through limited duration workshop emerged earlier. We also figured out that the contents that are so created in the process, namely the recorded lectures and the course material, if it lies within the institute alone, it may not be very effectively used. And therefore, we decided that as much as is possible, limited only by the willingness of the participating teachers here to give that content away, we decided that we'll try to make these contents available in open source to anybody and everybody who may wish to use that. Towards this end, we were supported by an important project on our e-outreach program by TIFAC. This is the council which does technology assessment, technology forecast and technology information. The TIFAC Council supported us through an important project. This project permitted us to conduct nutshell lectures and short workshops for participants both at IIT Bombay and through distance education program. An important hallmark of that project was development of methodology of properly editing the audio-visual contents and putting them in various formats which can be used at one extreme end for the rebroadcast of the course, what we call the highest end of digital video recording. At the other extreme was a simple interactive sort of learning material format in which the lecture slides were put together, a small video for the teacher was shown in one corner with an index. And this could compress the material that we were able to distribute in a single CD or a DVD. We conducted several such courses, distributed a lot of material in open source, and this helped us develop this technology to a level where today we are confident of conducting such programs as the IST workshop that we are sitting in today. However, in the process, we noticed one important thing. We noticed that not only these workshop contents, but even the contents of our other subjects for which lectures were recorded and distributed. An important component, for example, are the courses generated through the important NPTEL program. As you are aware, more than 200 courses have been created under NPTEL program, and they are available to all academic institutions. Not all of them are open source yet, but in the second phase, I am informed that all courses so created shall be in open source. When we interacted with faculty members and principals of other colleges to find out what was the adoption of these NPTEL courses, as also the open source material that we had created through these workshops supported by TIFAC, we found an interesting thing. While most teachers agreed that the quality of these courses and the technical depth was very good, naturally, because these were mostly based on the regular IIT courses and workshops. However, what they pointed out is that the way the material is covered and the way the questions are asked, these two things do not gel well with the conventional syllabus and the examination system that the colleges follow. And therefore, the students and teachers in these colleges are unable to use these courses as they are. That is because the lectures cover the material mostly from a problem-solving perspective rather than detailing each and everything as is done and as is required to meet the university syllabus demands. Similarly, the questions which are asked in our assignments are modeled on the IIT examination system, which is a completely free format examination system where every teacher who teaches a subject sets his or her own question paper, examines his or her own question paper. In fact, the syllabus, which is of course defined and available by Senate and is available to all the teachers, merely works as a guideline for the teacher. Every teacher in IIT system is free to expand on that syllabus to include new things that have happened in the recent past. Such a flexibility does not exist in the conventional university system or the college system. That appeared to be the most important reason why the material which has been created by the IIT system through NPTEL courses and which has been created by us through the open source workshops supported by TIFAC were not being used extensively in individual colleges by individual teachers. We therefore understood that whatever we have been doing is good but is not good enough. If we want to make it good enough, we must take cognizance of the fact that our teachers in large number of engineering colleges will be required to teach to a syllabus and will be required to prepare students such that the students are able to answer regular university examinations properly, thereby maximizing their score. After all, that is the sole ambition for most of the students, as I mentioned earlier. Consequently, when we designed the format of this workshop, we took cognizance of this particular aspect. This aspect we mention as the teaching learning of a subject in a typical college. When we studied such teaching learning process, we realized that first of all the syllabus is defined, quite often it is defined almost to a very exhaustive extent by defining how many modules must be taught, what should be the contents of each module, how many hours should be spent on teaching that module, and more importantly, how many marks of questions will be asked on that module in the examination. This is, according to us, a very straitjacketing system, but it is a fact that such system exists. Therefore, we decided that whenever we design a workshop for teachers, we must primarily address this concern and this objective which most teachers have to fulfill. We would of course not like to limit our interaction through this workshop with the teachers only to do this, because that would only mean that we will continue to depend only on the existing straitjacketed university system for our education. Our objective therefore in this workshop is twofold. First and foremost, enable the teachers to address the specific needs of that particular college and university as per the syllabus and as per that question paper pattern to be able to teach a subject more effectively. Equally importantly, we would like to enable the teacher to think a bit differently, what we call the IIT style of education. Please remember that IIT has not fallen from the sky. We teachers at IIT Bombay and our students are exactly like you teachers at other colleges and your students. The difference is the tremendous amount of flexibility that the system gives us, which permits us to constantly do experiments in teaching, evolve newer teaching methodologies, evolve newer assessment methodologies, and use them immediately in such experiments. This facility is not available to the teachers who are participating in this workshop and their colleagues in other colleges. However, I wish to submit that even in the straitjacketed system of the university, there is enough provision, either in terms of internal marks or in terms of internal evaluation, which can permit the enthusiastic teachers to perhaps take a few pointers from the IIT kind of teaching and experiment with these in their own colleges. Additionally, as I always say, there are 24 hours in a day, and the regular syllabus teaching might be limited to 8 hours in a day. There are still large number of hours available. I have seen examples of enthusiastic students and teachers in various small places doing some interesting experiments in teaching learning on their own, completely outside the syllabus. I would encourage our participating teachers to think of using that route as an additional route to try and imbibe some of the few things that we seem to have done well in the IIT system. That then is the objective of the workshop. More specifically, coming to the workshop detail. While you are all attending this workshop for 2 weeks, the objective of the workshop is not to let you go away after 2 weeks, but to engage you perpetually in a continuous dialogue on improving teaching learning of a subject that you participate in this workshop. This specific workshop is on computer programming, and therefore I will speak more on the computer programming, but we propose to conduct 12 such workshops in subsequent years on different core courses of engineering and science, as also few of the more popular and important electives or advanced courses. We are still in the process of finalizing what subjects we will choose, but what we have decided is that for every subject that we choose to conduct this workshop, the following methodology will be followed. The first part of this methodology consists of preparatory phase. While most of you have come here to attend this workshop today, and you will be physically engaged for the next 2 weeks. The preparation started more than 6 months ago. Since we were to conduct this workshop using the EDUSAT infrastructure, it was clear to us that physically all the teachers will not be assembling at IIT Bombay. And therefore, the laboratory, the tutorial exercises, the assignments, which are ordinarily conducted in an IST workshop with the coordinating teacher present, will not be feasible now. We therefore decided to use a hierarchical method of coordination. For this subject, for example, I am the subject coordinator, but since all of you are not here, we have appointed additional coordinators at each center. So each participating remote center is also as much responsible for coordinating the conduct of this workshop as I am in IIT Bombay. In fact, we all together form some kind of a coordinator's pool. To ensure that our colleague coordinators from remote centers are in sync in thinking and in adopting this methodology, we conducted a 1 week workshop for these coordinating teachers. They are naturally teachers of the same subject, namely computer programming, but more importantly, they were familiar with the university system of education in their respective physical areas. They knew, for example, what was the syllabus, what is the examination pattern, etc. These coordinators were requested to bring all that material here to IIT Bombay. We discussed that material and we have therefore evolved the syllabus for this particular workshop, keeping in mind the generally available syllabus in most universities and colleges, as could be ascertained from the participating coordinators. Additionally, we shared with them the way we run our laboratories, the way we run our tutorials, and the way we give assignments at IIT Bombay wherever we teach a subject. They have imbibed that philosophy and they have gone back and prepared the infrastructure in their respective institutions to provide the same kind of laboratory experience that you would have got at IIT Bombay itself. In the specific case of computer programming, we have ensured that the programming environment that we use here, namely Unix and C, is available exactly in the same fashion as is available to our students at IIT. These coordinating teachers have spent a lot of time in imbibing the knowledge of that particular environment. In turn, they have gone back and they have trained their own technical staff to provide the laboratory support and the tutorial support exactly the way you would have seen this support in IIT Bombay. This experiment has in fact worked out thanks to the extraordinary level of enthusiastic participation from the coordinating institutions and from the coordinators, for which I thank them. This has been the preparation work which has culminated in the beginning of this workshop. I shall briefly discuss the workshop schedule in a short while. However, I would like to now discuss the post-workshop activities. In fact, let me not jump the gun and actually discuss the workshop schedule itself first. I hope all of you have a copy of the workshop schedule here. So let me very quickly describe the workshop schedule to you and then I will get back to the post-workshop activities. We are here on Monday, we just finished the inaugural session and we are currently discussing the workshop details. We shall have a lecture after a 15-minute tea break on the general engineering education which I shall be delivering. Subsequently, by the way, the general structure is we shall have 3 hours of lectures in the morning and 3 hours of laboratory in the afternoon. You will notice that there is a special provision for 8 days of what we call active learning. This is being contributed by our colleagues and friends from Mission 10X, an important project undertaken by Wipro about which I and the mission people will speak separately to you. I must also announce a small change in the timetable here. We had originally scheduled it from 2 to 2:30. However, it was realized that the laboratories will be conducted in a separate place than the classroom where most of the participants are attending. In order to provide continuity for the classroom participation by teachers, we have decided to shift this 2 to 2:30 slot from 12:35 to 1 o'clock. Consequently, I request all coordinators to shift their lunch arrangement, not today, but from tomorrow, to 1 or 1:10 at most. So the lunch shall be from 1:10 to 2:30 instead of 12:35 to 2. This is because all the participants will be assembled for listening to the lectures here, and the Mission 10X people will continue using their presence in the same classroom for half an hour immediately after the last session in the morning. Now let us quickly look at the sessions that I have planned here. Since we have decided that the subject matter of computer programming at the introductory level shall be C programming alone, this is because most of the university syllabi actually introduce computer programming using C programming language. Kindly note that this is different from what we teach at IIT Bombay. I will talk about the IIT Bombay CS101 course offering in the subsequent lectures at the appropriate time. But our course uses C and C++ and emphasizes problem solving of a different kind. We have specially prepared, therefore, for this workshop a coverage which is adequately representative of the maximum number of syllabi that we could lay our hands on, namely basic C programming. If you look at the coverage from third day, third lecture onwards, we discuss data types in C, we discuss expressions, we discuss conditional execution, we discuss iteration, we discuss functions, arrays, we discuss character strings and structures, we discuss pointers and text files, we discuss random access files. We also discuss some data structures and aspects of software engineering. These are the lecture sessions which more or less cover the complete syllabus for the courses that are offered in your respective colleges. You will notice that introduction to computer hardware and introduction to operating system and compilers is also part of most of the syllabus. We do not believe that these items should be covered at the beginning. In our own course offering, these things are covered much later, except for the immediately required computing environment that students must be familiar with. However, for the sake of maintaining the discipline of following the university syllabi, we have included this material here. You will now wonder why we have other aspects such as course projects or examples and interaction or presentations on the last day. Let me briefly mention what these things are. I will cover these in greater details as we go by. A very important aspect of computer programming teaching at IIT Bombay is a team project which is done by a number of students. I will explain the concept of projects in greater details tomorrow when I deal with the course projects. Here, we take up a larger problem which needs to be solved by people. This enables our students to write not toy programs or 10 or 50 or 100 lines, but 2000 to 2500 lines, which is exactly what they would be writing in their career in their respective fields. We believe this is an important aspect of computer programming education, and therefore we would like to give you all a glimpse of such projects by requesting all participating teachers to take up such a project and actually write the program for this project as a part of this assignment. It will be an exciting endeavor, I assure you, and we'll talk about it more in tomorrow morning session. So this then is the structure of the 2-week workshop. Let me, in the concluding minutes, talk about the post-workshop activities. Ordinarily, an IST workshop starts on day one and ends after 2 weeks. What it means is that by the time, suppose I am a participating teacher like you, and I come from small place somewhere to a bigger city to attend this workshop, when I go back, there are not only days but several months for which my mind is completely inactive as far as that particular workshop contents are concerned. And that is because when I go back, I will naturally be involving myself into other duties and activities that I have in my own institution. I will be very lucky if I am teaching the same subject immediately upon my return to the institution. But that is rather unlikely to happen. Consequently, later on when I get a chance to teach that subject, 6 months or even a year might have passed. Certainly a few months would have passed. Consequently, whatever I discussed during the workshop, whatever I learned during the workshop has become very stale in my mind already. We do not want that to happen with our colleague teachers who have assembled here to enhance the effectiveness of their teaching process. We, in fact, would like to accommodate a much larger number of teachers and students to continuously participate in this kind of endeavor to keeping the association with teaching learning process in association of the subject matter alive almost constantly. We have therefore designed this workshop slightly differently than the conventional IST workshops. In conventional IST workshops, when you finish attending the workshop, you get a participation certificate. In here, you will be required to carry out certain assignments which I had outlined in the theme paper, which I hope you have all read. More specifically, we propose to build question banks with answers. We propose to build additional teaching learning material to which all participating teachers will be expected to contribute. We shall, during the workshop, define exactly what activity each participating teacher has to undertake and fulfill subsequent to the completion of the workshop. We will be giving 2 more weeks for the participating teachers to complete this activity. This is because in the next 2 weeks, they are likely to be relatively free, because after that, their own colleges and their own duty cycles will start. Only after receipt of these assignments that the teachers submit to the coordinating institutions where they are attending this course, their certificates will be dispatched by the coordinating institution. We have IST's approval on this mode of conduct of IST workshop. So, because the time period of our physical interaction is limited to 2 weeks, as a matter of fact, only 10 days for this particular workshop, I request all teachers to start considering what kind of activities they can undertake when they go back. Jointly with the coordinators at remote centers, we will be assigning specific activities both to individuals and to groups of teachers who are participating. I will elaborate more on this tomorrow. Suffice it to say that this activity is expected to keep teachers associated with the mindset of this workshop even after they go back home. Do we stop after the additional 2 weeks that the teachers are expected to spend on completing the assigned work? The answer is no, because the dream is far bigger. Please remember that while we are very happy to have about 1,000 teachers assembled across the country, and as I said, this is happening for the first time that such a large number of teachers have come in to attend a single program. But you will all agree that this large number also is a minuscule if you compare the total number of teachers who are teaching this subject, computer programming, for example. Just to do some arithmetic, as I said, almost all first year students in all engineering colleges are required to study computer programming. Additionally, computer programming is taught in many management institutions and in many science colleges through the route of BSc IT. Thus, the number of teachers who have no clue on what is happening in this workshop is far in excess of the number which is attending. If 1,000 teachers are attending today this workshop, I can assure you that there are at least 20,000 teachers engaged in teaching computer programming across the country who are not benefiting from this interaction. How do we ensure that we rope them in? More importantly, how do we ensure that lakhs of students who study this subject can directly benefit from whatever we deliberate upon in this workshop and later? The answer to that, as we propose, is to set up a subject portal. Effective teaching learning of computer programming will not be limited to the conduct of this workshop. Somewhere around March or April, we will be launching a subject portal on computer programming. This subject portal shall contain all the open source contents that we have created, including audio-visual lectures which are recorded, the question banks, the text contents, the laboratory exercises. Everything will be included here. Additionally, we will encourage all the teachers and students to contribute to these contents in coming years. Therefore, this website or this portal shall be an interactive portal. My own personal hope is that for each such subject that we launch a portal, let that portal be the biggest source of useful educational information to our teachers and students across the country teaching or learning that particular subject. This then is the larger perspective. This then is the larger objective. In some sense, all my 1,000 colleagues who have assembled here for this workshop are going to be pioneers in this effort. Please note that in open source content creation, the contents are not recorded and displayed on a website anonymously. Due credits are given to each and every contributor who contributes to these contents. All the teachers who contribute to question banks or who contribute to additional contents in terms of either slides or examples or even video clips will be duly acknowledged, and that acknowledgement will stay on the website permanently. That indeed is the reward that most academics seek while contributing to open source. So what Professor Kannan mentioned as open source contents is not limited only to open source software, but is also includes all the educational contents that we can think of. Together, therefore, we hope to create such useful contents, not only now, not only in the past 6 months what we have done, not only what we'll do during these 2 weeks of workshop, not only what our participating teachers will do in 2 additional weeks, but even in subsequent months and years, whenever they actually use this material to increase the effectiveness of their teaching learning process in their colleges, whatever additional contributions come from them or their colleagues or their students will all land up in this portal. We are setting up a large infrastructure for which we hope to receive adequate grants from the ministry very soon, and this infrastructure shall be utilized to launch such portals one by one, which should be accessible to not only us, but to all our colleague teachers who are not able to attend this workshop and to all the students who will study this subject in future. That then is the larger perspective of the workshop. Let me conclude this session by once again welcoming you. As I told you in the morning, this is almost like a monologue as far as I am concerned, because I can't see you, I can't hear you. However, I hope that the work that has been done by our ISRO colleagues has enabled you to receive the video and audio without any disturbance. The few sessions that are specifically earmarked as interaction sessions are meant for our participating teachers to ask questions and to be seen and heard, not only by us here at IIT Bombay, but all other participants across the country. With that, I will conclude this session. Thank you so much.